Okay, so everyone look down at your watches. Does anyone's watch say it's not 9 a.m.? Raise your hand if it's not 9 a.m. Okay, welcome. Cool. So welcome to the earliest, most thought-provoking, brain-squeezing thing that you've ever done after a night of partying. Was it Wednesday? It is Wednesday. So my name is Colin McNamara. I'm the chief cloud architect at a company called Nexus. Actually, we just got bought by a giant company called Dimension Data. We're here today to share with you some of the tool sets that some amazing developers have made. We have Mr. Mark Maglana, and I'll introduce him a little bit more just in a couple slides, and Mr. Aimon Bustardo. Aimon and Mark are on our upstream development team over at Nexus, a Dimension Data company. So today we're going to have a workshop, so if you have your laptops with you, actually, I'll ask a question. Who came in for a talk and who came in for a workshop? Talk. Who's just expecting to sit and listen? You can do that. That is acceptable. But who came in with their laptops ready to be able to do stuff? Awesome. So keep your hands up really quick. Okay, loose count. It's about 20 of you, 30 of you. Okay, close enough. So if my clicker would work. Maybe if I turn on my clicker, it'd work. So one of the goals that me, the community, and my team have is lowering the barriers to consuming and contributing to OpenStack. Been in the community for 2.5 years now. Came in about 2011. Minor contributor since then, co-founder project. And one of the biggest challenges that we have is people who want to contribute, who want to fix a bug, who want to submit a patch. The steps to that are really, really hard. And so what we're going to do here is we're going to kind of get things started of transferring some files over with. We're going to introduce Aimon and Mark. And during the time it takes to transfer the files over, so everyone has the data, we're just going to talk a little bit about what and why we've done this and do a code walkthrough. And then we'll go ahead and help you guys through kind of a self-paced workshop. So let's go ahead and start transferring files. So first thing first, we have, I think, 10 or 12 USB keys.
Nine.
We have 9 USB keys. We have 30 people, so that means 3 to 4. So group up in teams of 4, if you can, please. So everyone raise your hand who brought your laptop. Okay, look at each other. Look left and right. Those are your new best buddies for the next 90 minutes. Okay, you're going to have to learn to share. You're going to have to learn to communicate. This is a relationship building workshop. It's for building love and friendships in the OpenStack community. So it also is because, to be perfectly honest, I submitted this as a workshop. I thought it was a presentation, and I spent half of Monday finding USB keys and realizing they're really expensive. So please, also, if you can return the really expensive USB keys to me, I would really love that. I love storage, but I don't want to own. I don't have to pay for this out of my pocket. Okay.
Who we got? Come on, why don't you guys huddle up here a little bit? And,
sorry.
Okay. Oh, yeah. So it takes about 12. So part of the estimation is between 5 and 12 minutes to transfer files.
Yep.
Right. So just want transfer the files on these folders. There is what on the USB drive.
Yeah. Everything. Put it in one folder in your desktop, and then we'll work on that.
Speak louder, please.
Hello. Yes.
Yeah. Speak louder.
Yeah. So copy everything that's in the USB key and put it in one folder in your desktop. That way we can access it easily.
Okay. And don't delete it. And no viruses, please. if you're a Windows and a Mac user, there's VirtualBox is on there. If you're a Linux user, it's about 50 billion different files or 50 billion different builds. So if you're a Linux user, please go and download VirtualBox on your own. And start updating your dependencies. Is that correct?
Double check though. I think there's a Linux installer for VirtualBox in the USB key, I think.
Okay.
So all that you would really need to download would be the
libqt
vbguest plugin.
Okay.
For Vagrant.
Cool. Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So most people don't follow the prerequisites, so I really thank you for reading.
Yeah, if you have VirtualBox installed already, you don't need it, obviously, to reinstall it off the USB key. You still need the rest of the files, the project files, on the USB key, though.
Who pre-installed VirtualBox?
Oh, my. Awesome. Woo-hoo! Perfect.
That is so awesome.
You guys are great.
No, it's okay. You don't have... okay. look at the people who raised their hands before and see what you're supposed to do. No, it's fine. I never do the prerequisites. I'm horrible.
There is, however, VirtualBox for
guys.
Like 7 flavors of Linux on that USB key, as well as Windows and OS X. So you should be covered. If you don't have it, it will be on that USB key, unless you're running some very obscure version of Linux or running something that is just even more obscure than that.
I have another USB key that we can pass around, by the way.
Yep.
Who need? Oh, wait, no. I see a whole bunch of individuals. Everyone who needs one, come up and fight for the death. Groups of four. We all get together. No. We all get together. Okay, 2 more people come over and sit next to them so we don't have communication issues. We don't have a USB key waiting. So if you are done transferring, raise your hand, say, who's next? I gave the last one away, so. Because you have crappy internet access at a workshop or at a conference like this, we basically pre-warmed up the controller images, all the different nodes, and set it up so it'll work on offline mode.
The project files are separate than the installers, as you'll see when you get the USB key. So it's a fairly short copy if you don't need the installers. The larger chunk is the VirtualBox installer and all that junk. So it's a relatively small copy if you just need the images.
And the repo is public, so it's on GitHub. So when you go at home, there's whatever. You can use whatever you want, Apache 2.0. So let me introduce your mentors. While we're transferring and fighting over USB keys, again, it's all right. If there's a really good fight, document it, share it.
Makes us all have fun.
I want to introduce people that are really important to me. They're really important to the community, and I think a lot of times we don't get a chance to validate these people. So first and foremost, Mark Maglana. He's standing right here. He's a QA engineer at a Nexus Dimension Data company, and is absolutely amazing. He's a great tester and a great developer that understands the value of test-driven development. There you go. He also does more than QA testing. He actually wrote our multi-cloud bidding code, which is really cool, the Goddamn Commoditizer run. We can talk about that later. But that really does some really interesting things. That's outside the scope of this discussion. He's an OpenStack active technical committer, creator. Did I screw up your airframe again?
Yeah, it's Aviator.
Hey, damn it. Okay, it's Aviator. Okay, please, I need you to create a project named Airframe so I get it right. He's also the creator of a really cool tool that we use for our own project management, Rosetta. If you use Trello, anyone does Scrumbon, use Trello, Kanban, Scrum. Anyone try to pull data out of it, it's absolute crap. Right, because it's optimized for speed and security, not accuracy. He wrote this awesome tool that is in preview release. Has the test been updated?
Yeah.
It's in preview release that actually normalizes data out of that. He's just a really awesome, interesting dude. And so the code that we're going through today is Mark's code that he had to do, that Mark and Eamon paired up on, but I think you were the lead on it, right?
Yeah.
To be able to troubleshoot some multi-node dev stack or multi-node Neutron API timeout issues and submit some patches in Tempest so there's better coverage. Now, Aimon Bustardo, who I couldn't find a good picture of, I'm going to be taking some like selfies with you, is also another amazing guy.
A horrible picture.
You like that?
Yeah, no.
No?
That's okay. I never like pictures of myself anyways.
Huh? Can anyone else having permission issues copying? No? Okay.
How would you have
pair programming? If your friends troubleshoot it, send it to another. There shouldn't be any permission issues copying.
Especially copying.
Copying shouldn't have it.
It's if you can see it, you can copy it.
Yeah.
It's read, baby.
So we do. We use Mac, as most of our friends do. So Mac should be. This should work a lot on Mac. We haven't tested it on Linux, but it should. Right.
It'll work on Linux.
If you're running Windows, I'm very, very sorry. So Aimon Bustardo is a really awesome Ruby developer who hides his awesome Ruby developer world under like an amazing DevOps engineer banner. So he's a number 2 contributor, I believe, to Puppet OpenStack?
Used to be? Yeah.
Probably going to be again.
Hopefully.
Yeah. He is an undercover ninja, I believe. What's your martial art?
Oh, Shaolin.
Shaolin, okay. Is that Ninja? Or is that like...
No, wrong country, but that's okay.
It shows how worldly I am, right? And he's a development engineer. They're all architects in the highest level of skill that we have in our company. He's a development engineer at Nexus. And so work on our internal and external projects. I'm Colin McNamara. I'm Chief Cloud Architect, Director of our Cloud Practice. Been in the OpenStack community for 2.5 years now. It's really great to see everyone joining it. I'm a core reviewer for OpenStack Manuals, co-founder of OpenStack Training. Been a heavy Linux user, and I am the chief architect of an amazing beard and an amazing family. So, what's that? No? Okay. So, why do this? I think that, I talked a little bit, so is everyone transferring? Who's got the first files transferred yet? Okay, did you pass it over to a friend? No? Not done? Okay. So we're only like 10 minutes into a 90-minute thing. And by the way, there's some videos available so you can self-pace. There's a self-paced guide so you can self-paste. Oh, there's the full upstream code so when you're connected so you can self-paste. Why did we go ahead and have to solve this problem? I'm going to talk a little bit about the problem statement for the customer. I'm going to hand it over to Mark and Maglana to talk a little bit more about the challenges you were trying to face. We had a customer that a service provider customer that we're engaged with, and they had chosen to create an Ubuntu-based OpenStack cloud. Most of the work we do at Nexus is infrastructure-based. We upstream selectively. We try to partner with our customers. Customers facing a problem with escalating API timeouts when they're using overlapping IP addresses in Neutron. The requests for the requests in the APIs are escalating to 12 to 15 seconds. And honestly, I didn't want to fix it. They kind of thrown their cloud into production. I'm not in the business of throwing really really smart people to respond to other people's emergencies. I'm in the business of helping them and help others. And so what we did is I made a decision to say, okay, well, yeah, we'll help you, but we're going to help you by improving the Tempest coverage. So this doesn't happen to you again, and this doesn't happen to the community again. So whenever we can find good for our business, good for our customer, good for the community, we want to do it. And so the goal was to be able to improve the Tempest suite. And who knows what Tempest is? Good. Okay. If for those who don't, Tempest is a quality control suite that allows us to develop OpenStack safely. It's, as Mark puts it, the seatbelts that allow us to drive fast. And that area of development, Neutron was driving without seatbelts. So we went ahead and entered into development on multi-node Neutron, or specifically QA, improving the QA test suites for Neutron in overlapping IP addresses in a multi-node setup, and had obviously challenges. Developing on single node DevStack is easy-ish. Developing on something that looks like a production environment is hard. So I'll give Mark the mic really quick, and you can talk a little bit about what you were doing, and then maybe you can do a code walkthrough.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're mic'd.
Aren't mic'd.
Let me get you out of this one.
It's fine. So while he's setting that up, you got a USB key?
Well, it's corrupt.
It's corrupt. We killed one. Okay. Crap. Yes. Then if you have a spare USB key, once you're done with your USB key, stand up. If you're team of four, we don't need USB keys sitting around. And one of these days, we'll find a good way of running a workshop at a conference. And maybe we'll do like you have to show up 3 hours before and get your data or something like that. I don't know. So Mark's logging on right now, trying to. And I'm going to go basically talk in Yapple so he doesn't have to worry about focusing on both. Internally in our development, we use Amazon a lot. We build OpenStack locally. We use Garrett Jenkins just like everyone else. And there is Mark. So you want to talk about the why you were doing and the problem, like the challenges you faced,
sure.
And then kind of what your decisions were, and then your walkthrough.
Yeah. I used to do a lot of development on top of OpenStack. As Colin mentioned, I created Aviator, which is a library that allows a Ruby developer to communicate with an OpenStack installation. I also, in my previous employer, I developed I helped create the a dashboard that talks to OpenStack. But I have never had experience until I joined Nexus in setting up OpenStack and actually setting up OpenStack to develop help develop OpenStack. And this was my first opportunity to do just that. So I heard, to get started developing an OpenStack, it's a good thing to have DevStack in your local machine, and that's where you code with, or that's how you test your code or integrate your code with the rest of OpenStack. Now, I'm a fan of README-driven development, where I basically when I start a project, I first write out the README to, tell the next developer how to set up the software in his local machine. And then after writing the README, I use that as one of my guides when I code. When I started writing the README for, setting up DevStack and setting up Tempest, it was lengthy. So I decided, well, maybe I can automate this. So I started with Vagrant, which is a great way to automatically spin up VMs, in your VirtualBox environment or your VMware environment, your local machine. And then I, went ahead and wrote some Puppet manifests. I'm not here, full disclosure, by the way, I'm not very good at Puppet. Aimon here is way, way better than me on that one. But, I did my best to write something that was easy to follow. So the prerequisites for this, you guys already have that. If you went ahead and looked at the README PDF in the USB, the prerequisite is VirtualBox, Vagrant. There is also the VB Guest plugin. Instructions are also in the README, and then we'll go together. We'll walk through the whole launching the controller and the compute node at the same time when you guys. When most of you are ready. So a little walkthrough of, it's a bit small. I wonder if we can adjust the.
You can embiggen it.
Yeah.
Control plus plus, right?
Control plus plus,
Think.
Yeah, you should be able to zoom there.
This is the Tempest.
There you
Excuse
go.
Me? This is Tempest, this is not Tempest. You may have Tempest open.
Go
this
to Windows, is, yeah. Go to Windows Zoom.
So right now, it's going to go inside and go through
No, that's not it.
And as we go, figure out how to zoom this. That's the README and DevStack templates.
Oh, there he goes.
Oh, thank
Man
you.
Man in the back taking care of you.
All righty. Awesome. You guys are awesome.
So that's.
All right, so this is the entire DevStack-Tempest project that I created and put up in GitHub. So a little walkthrough of the contents of this one. Yep.
One more, the GitHub location, it's in the Nexus.is. So github.com/Nexus.is. And then it's.
/ DevStack-Tempest.
Yeah.
The ones that you have right now that you copied is slightly modified so that we don't have to download, the source of. OpenStack from the internet. It's all going to be local, so it's a bit different, but most of it is the same as what I have there in the GitHub repo. Right. So the main file here in DevStack Tempest is of course the README, because we do RDD here. And then here is the Vagrant file, which we will use to spin up those two VMs, the controller and the compute node. I've defined two nodes over here, the controller, and then basically this definition tells Vagrant, what's the RAM of the VM that it needs to spin up, what are the provisioners that it needs to use. Down here, I've specified two types of provisioners, the shell provisioner and a puppet provisioner. So once the VM is up and running, Vagrant will then hand over the control to Puppet to configure those VMs. So the Puppet manifests are inside the Puppet directory, and then the shell provisioning scripts are there under the shell directory. There is a Tempest directory which is not immediately available when you download the repository from GitHub because that's part of the provisioning process. So the cool thing about this project that I really like is once you spin up those two VMs, Puppet will also configure Tempest inside of your controller, and then put the Tempest project in a shared directory. That way, you can and the shared directory shared between the local machine and your controller VM. That way, you can still edit Tempest using your favorite editor in your local machine, and be able to run the test inside of your controller VM. So that's my favorite part. All right, status of everyone. Everyone, who else is still copying their files? Okay, cool. So that's not going to be a problem. We have a video walkthrough that we will share online. And also, I have a screen.
My fault.
I also have screenshots in the USB disk that you can use to walk through each of the steps. Alrighty.
Cool.
Cool. All right. So let me get started on this one.
Okay. So that in memory, you can self-pace on this. This is community. Everything's open source. It's all the PDFs are there. So, and it's going to start the walkthrough. We're not leaving people behind. That's why we have to be cognizant of time. Yes, sir. It's github.com/nexusis, and inside of there, there's a DevStack Tempest.
Because no one's going to be able to get that.
I'm going to let Mark get going here.
Yeah, just we'll just let them deal with it later. Okay. All right, so one of the things that we need to make sure is set up over here is the VirtualBox networking. You go over to the VirtualBox preferences window right here, and just make sure that you have this host-only network with the following settings. Its IP address is 192.168.42.1. And
same IP address?
Yes. That way, you don't have to mess around with the code, because it assumes this IP address. Of course, later on, you can you can modify this and also modify the vagrant file settings. Sorry. What was that? Sorry. You click on, yeah, you can't see it from there. It's click on the VirtualBox menu on the top bar, just right beside the Apple logo over there. Preferences. Yeah, VirtualBox preferences. And then that's how you get to this one. Sorry, what was that?
I was going to ask, are these the screenshots I saw on the folder?
Yes, yes. Perfect. Exactly. It's going to be exactly the same as the screenshots in the USB drive. So once you get to the preference pane of VirtualBox, make sure that you have this host-only network with this settings. And also make sure that the DHCP server is disabled. We're going to make Vagrant assign the IP addresses of our two nodes, the controller and the compute node. All right? Oh, sorry. Address of the network is 192.168.42.1. And the mask is 255.255.255.0. And leave everything else the same.
What did you do for DHCP?
Disabled.
Just disabled. Uncheck the enable DHCP right there. All right, moving forward. Yeah, we'll leave everything else alone. You probably don't have this yet because you haven't started your compute nodes yet, or and controller node. The next step really is just to say
Zoom.
Let me just move that one over there.
There you go.
Here we go.
Too far.
Down low.
Mark.
Oh. I have to look at that one, not this one.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay.
He's unzooming you.
All righty. Okay. So make sure that you have Vagrant, VBguest. The instructions on how to install VBguest is there in the PDF. So it's Vagrant plugins. Vagrant plugin install VBguest, I think. Yeah, is that it? So Vagrant plugin install Vagrant-VBguest. Right? And
so I'm sorry, I'm feeling really stupid because
no, go ahead, sorry.
Like what you're saying, it's not different than the README file, but it's like you just did one big step that's not in the README file, so I'm not sure who I should follow.
Sorry, what was the step that you
the whole network, setting up the private or the host network, that wasn't in here, so you did that. And I'm sure that I don't think the order matters, but I'm
right. Yeah, I apologize for that one.
I was kind of confusing, and I don't know if I'm the only one that's bringing it. On one hand, I'd rather you read the README file, but if you're putting up steps that I need that aren't here, then I'm going to be really out of sync.
Yeah, I apologize for the networking part. Apparently, I didn't do very well with a README-driven development this time around.
I'll call out on this. So it's also my fault for basically being totally disorganized and deciding to go to Hawaii after the company was acquired instead of working on this. a week in Maui instead of doing this is my choice. How we like to approach community is this is what we share, what we know. You know, we're not trying to share we're perfect. We're just trying to share with people some of the lessons we've learned. And thanks for the feedback on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's community. We're not paid to be here.
We'll get the README properly fixed. I need to do some automated testing on the README file.
Yeah.
Can you do that?
Cool.
I don't know.
So, is that possible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, there is. It's called an intern.
Yeah. So if anyone wants to volunteer to test our testing of testing code, we have job openings like everyone else on Earth.
Is anybody else having trouble with the networking bit?
Could you just go through one more time quickly?
Sorry, one really stupid What's question. Wrong? Your network was called VBox. Mine has some long name. Does it matter?
Yes.
No.
The question was if your network was the network name matters. No, it doesn't.
Yes, done.
No.
It's done. That's okay.
Okay.
Yeah, network name does not matter.
Yeah, yep.
Cool.
Downloading the
Vagrant.
Vagrant?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do you want to continue moving forward?
Yeah.
Well, so
the Vagrant installer is also in the USB disk.
Oh, really?
Yeah. We should not download anything.
Yeah, for Windows, no. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any specific version of Vagrant you have to use?
No.
Just latest.
Latest would be great.
So, to be cognizant of time,
no promises if it's super old.
Yeah.
Yep.
So we'll keep on going to make sure, again, we can do this self-paced. This is a videotape. We want to make sure everyone can at least reference the working stuff here.
Yep.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, so the code's online that you can do it yourself. Yeah, we will. Yeah. We did. It's Nexus. Go to github.com/NexusIS, and it's the Vagrant DevStack repo on here.
All right.
We'll make sure to post it at the end as well.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to go ahead and fire up the compute node. So, once you have your environment set up, it's, just say Vagrant up compute. And then --- provision, just to be sure that it actually does the provisioning part. Most of the time, you don't need this last part, but it's good to have that around.
Okay, and I hate to be so pedantic. On the README, it's in the opposite order. They're doing the controller first. I assume there's not a big difference.
Very good. Yes, that's me just being an airhead. Yeah, you should be Vagrant up controller first, and then the compute.
Yeah, if you don't bring the controller up first, it's not.
Yeah. So let me clean this up.
So.
All right, Vagrant.
You could destroy it.
Up.
Excuse me.
You could destroy the compute.
Yeah, we'll do that. Controller.
I believe so. Yeah.
No, he's in a bash shell right now.
It's just a terminal in your local machine.
Then you will want a Sigwin or something similar so that you can run in.
Now in Vagrant, you can just use command line. If you've installed Vagrant, it should be on your, it should have installed on your path.
Oh, okay, just
use, oh, there you go.
Yeah.
It also, if you install the Windows virtual box, Git includes
some kind of shell.
Yeah. And nice. Full disclosure, we don't use Windows.
Yeah.
literally, a friend of mine brought in a Mac and opened and booted Windows on it, and I cussed him out. And, well, he wasn't a friend then, but it started a friendship.
I did this about 2 weeks ago because my arm was twisted. It actually is not too bad on Windows.
Okay. Like, well, some of our business process guys
I think
are
the tools are getting better
too.
On Windows because some people have to because of the jobs they work.
Right. Yeah. Some people choose to work places where they don't have to.
We welcome your feedback on the Windows.
Hey, Aimon, can you help me?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've just walked before.
You have a bring your own Apple policy, so BYONA.
There you go.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Is there any reason why you didn't make the metal separate?
Network node separate.
Yeah.
Resources.
Oh.
And the computer.
Yeah. So I forgot to mention, for this demo, we're just going to do the simple DevStack. We're setting up, you know, it's not Neutron based yet. It's Nova Network yet to keep things simple. One of the reasons is because there's very limited RAM in my local machine. So, you know, I wanted to keep it simple just to demonstrate. You know, you can automate your setting up of DevStack using Vagrant.
But you mentioned about multi-node deployments.
Yeah.
So definitely you have.
Well, this is multiple.
Yeah, it's
nodes.
Multi-node. Just the compute and the multi-node controller for now.
The controller and compute.
Yeah. Yes. So if anyone's the challenge that we've seen is if you actually look at we also do some development for Open Daylight. And doing DevStack, multiple nodes. So if you're going to do like Open Daylight ML2, Southbound and Neutron, so Neutron ML2 ODL, to actually do any testing on that, to actually develop on it, you need multi-node. On the ODL side, when we're trying to get Open Daylight into the gate, because Open Daylight is a reference SDN controller for OpenStack, it's not in the gate, so you can't really develop into it. And so what do you have to do there? Run Tempest against DevStack, right? So there was working with Mestre, who's also now the PTL for Neutron, Maduva Dorbital, Florian Hotel, and Brent Salisbury. You know, there's a lot of, especially on the ODL side, they're like really great networking guys, and obviously Kyle is a great OpenStack guy. It's just a giant cluster. Right, it was just a whole bunch of focus on getting people set up, like they come new to the project and getting multi-node DevStack set up. We kind of take for granted that we got it figured out. And so this was one to make it so we can make it easier for us to develop. But then also so the community wouldn't face the same darn challenge. Right, so whether you're doing multi-node Neutron, multi-node Nova Network, multi-node whatever, the same challenges are getting your stack RC files, mapping out your the VirtualBox images into like a local, so you can use your local IDE, stuff like that. I don't want to interrupt Mark unless you're waiting for something to do.
I just wanted to show, you know, this part over here, the VM is, the controller node is ready and it's installing DevStack. And I can SSH to the controller using Vagrant SSH controller. And then I can follow the installation of DevStack by just tailing the logs over here. This also, this step is also included in those screenshots in which you copied. And so that's it. This is Puppet putting DevStack inside the machine and then running it. And then once DevStack is done installing you know, the OpenStack services, it will then add an entry into the log into the configuration file, offline equals true. That way, the next time you run DevStack, it's not going to download everything from you know, from the repos again. If you want to make it download from the original repos, you can just take out the that entry from the config file. So over here, DevStack is done. And then it's just setting up additional stuff inside of the VM. That way, any instances that you spin up in OpenStack later will be able to communicate outside. There were some tiny little stuff that you need to play around with, you know, in VirtualBox.
Can you show in the Puppet code how this, where the StackRC file gets populated from? Or is that an Aimon thing?
The StackRC file?
Yeah, yeah. So you populate the DevStack.
Oh, yes. So first of all, that's really all that gets added to DevStack offline equals true. And in the manifest, where did I put that?
I think it's in Computing Controller, right?
I believe it's in nodes. No, I think you're right. It's in the controller. There it is. So it's just the file line plugin. It adds, you know, whatever is the entry in offline.txt, adds that to local.conf.
And then the passwords and IP addresses and all that, which file was that hidden inside on here? You know what I'm talking about? Because you're passing configurations to the DevStack itself.
Yep. Those are static files right here.
Uh-huh.
So for the controller, if you want to set up, you know, if you want to add some more stuff to the DevStack installation, this is really just, you know, DevStack configuration file that Puppet, you know, loads into the machine, and then DevStack sees this, and that's what it uses to configure OpenStack.
And for us, you know, it's like, okay, how do you actually take a development team out of a single developer and get them consistently using the same environment? How do you make that consistent between your laptop, your build environment? How do you make it so that you can bring people in? And I think one of the challenges we have in OpenStack and Open Daylight development is that we bring people in and out of projects, and development environment setup is actually a big barrier, and a lot of people leave. And so that's one of the goals of sharing this, is that I hope each of you are either new to a project or core to a project or bringing people in and can start, you know, understanding the code and hopefully maybe improve it. So continue. Are we up?
Sorry, there's a question over there.
Speak loud. You speak in the microphone so the tapes can hear you.
In the VirtualBox examples, you have a controller and a compute node already configured with Fedora 20 or something like that?
It's Ubuntu.
Ubuntu, okay. Mm-hmm. Did you have to specify the network adapters in those VMs?
Yes, it's already configured over here in the files, I believe.
Yeah, so for if you go
you don't have to manually specify anything. The Vagrant file, you know, specifies the IP address of the VM, and also
you don't have to do anything in VBox to tell it to use the host only network.
No, it should be automatic, mainly because. Right here, because of that entry inside of a VM definition.
So when you define the Ubuntu VMs, you didn't have to set up the Ethernet 1, Ethernet 2 adapters?
That's what Vagrant does over here.
So you may, if you have DHCP on this segment, though, you might be hitting a conflict. You might need to set up a private segment.
Okay.
Yeah. Good.
Thank you. Okay.
So, do you want to show through? Yep.
I ran into this. I don't know if you want to throw that up, but if you have a newer version of VBguest, it'll fail to mount the shared folder. There's a workaround if you Vagrant SSH in and do a symlink. So that does seem to work. So I got
well,
that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Is it this problem?
Aimon.
Same problem.
Whoa, hey.
Same problem.
Whoa.
Ah! My God.
Oh, so let's not crowd. Let's not crowd. Sorry. Pop it up and show it if you want. So the same problem was symlinking the files? Was it symlink in the folder share?
So that's in the VM. You just do that, and then I basically halt it, and you know, retrieve it.
Oh, cool.
So the question, you want to repeat the question statement and the problem?
So the problem was when you run Vagrant, it couldn't share mount the shared folders. So you just need to do this step inside of the VM, and then rerun Vagrant up controller dash dash provision. And that should work.
So while everyone's doing that, do you want to show how the why of the mapping of folders, so of how when you have multiple nodes? So as Mark's shown that, who uses rmate or rsub to be able to use like Sublime or TextMate or whatever your IDE is from DevStack? Like, do you use DevStack inside of a VM and you develop using an IDE on your laptop? Okay, I do. Who goes and just use Emacs if you're evil or VI if you're awesome to do it on DevStack itself? Okay, who develops on DevStack? Okay, cool. So when you do start developing on DevStack, you'll probably find that because DevStack is basically able to clone the repos locally, and you can make your changes. It runs everything inside of a screen instance, and so you can basically restart that process, make sure it works, run your tests. There's some times when maybe like I love Sublime because you know I'm not as good as these guys, and so being able to have an IDE that has a whole bunch of whizbang is really cool for me. But since I'm developing on another VM, I either have to transfer files, I have to do like a reverse SSH tunnel. It's a pain in the rear. In a single instance, you can kind of do it. You can basically set up your reverse tunneling. And when you have multiple instances, it gets really dirty really quick. And so one of the things that Mark found was ability to basically do folder mapping so you're always working in your local file system. And so you don't have to set up those hacks. It's just another thing that allows you to develop faster. So
to show that, here is, you know, I'm back inside of the controller, and I just go to Vagrant Tempest. And here is my Tempest directory. I can, you know, put stuff inside of that, and it'll show up right there. And this is my local machine. So that's, you know, that's, I think that's a very handy thing to have. You don't have to fumble around with, you know, setting up rmate or, you know, the equivalent of Sublime, or, you know, changing your IDE just because your code is inside of that VM.
One important caveat to that is that hard links do not work on that file system.
Yeah.
At all. And they have no plans to make them work. There is an alternate way that you can set up your Vagrant file, which will export an NFS file system.
Really?
Another note too is a lot of people are having problems getting the VBguest plugin installed under OS X. Depending on which version you have and the underlying libraries, if that's the case, the only thing you're going to lose, obviously, is the shared file system. But there are other ways around it, as you know, someone just mentioned. So don't let that stop you from continuing. Skip it if it's that much of a problem for you today, and you know you can work on something like that from home, so that you can progress with the rest of the workshop.
Sorry.
So, anyways, yeah. So VBguest, if it's killing you, just skip it. The only thing you're going to lose is that shared file system.
And I'm just going to repeat what you said, so it's on the video. So, and let me just make sure I'm making it back right. So, the hard symlinks aren't supported in the fault folder sharing, but inside of Vagrant, you can basically set NFS exports, and you mount that NFS share from those VMs. And this is not pushing back stance, but if you have any links to that, or maybe if you want to throw a note or a pull request into the Git repo.
Does on the hypervisor or host system whatever require you to put in a root password?
Okay.
Unless you put a sudo root entry in and it says.
Yeah, it probably.
So every time you stand up a VM, you have to put in your root password to get the export to work.
Okay. But yeah, no, that actually sounds really, really cool, because that gets around some of the issues if you want to do this inside VMware. So if you have Fusion on, because VMware doesn't, at least I haven't been able to figure out how to map the direct, how to specify what folders get mapped in. It just provides like a root guest or a guest folder mapped in. I have Fusion on my stuff. And, although I like to try to make sure everything we do in community-wise is VirtualBox, so, because you never know, like someone in India, Saigon, who's really, really smart but doesn't have a lot of money, you know, we don't want to basically say this is how we do it and then we can't have them join the community.
Question.
Yes, sir.
When you test out in your development environment?
Ours. It's theirs. I mean, they work for me, but.
You guys don't use multi-compute nodes and test out
the. Yeah, we do.
You do? Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, for this, the goal of this was to make sure that we're improving Tempest test coverage, so the community and our customers and ourselves didn't hit this fault. By the way, if you want to drive a hole through gaps of test coverage in the Tempest suite, you can probably just close your eyes and drive in direction. You'll find it. Okay.
So guys, if you are going to skip VB guest. You'll need to comment out two lines of the Vagrant file. The one there, can you just highlight it?
What it says.
Yeah, that line that Mark's highlighting right now, if you can't get VBguest installed for whatever reason, comment out that line that he's highlighting in your Vagrant file. Otherwise, it'll complain that you don't have the plugin.
There's another one down there.
Yeah, okay. there's one for the compute, one for the controller. Make sure those are both commented out, and you can continue booting your Vagrant images. And then you'll be able to continue with the workshop.
Okay.
All right. So once your controller node is up and running, then you know you can access it from the browser.
Can
we look at hypervisors? We don't have anything there.
Can I put one safety statement here? Sorry to interrupt you. One thing that I think I had in that note that we're supposed to talk about or when we had breakfast. This is not a POC environment. This is not a demo environment. This is a development environment. If you're planning on taking this back to your shop and showing you having your developers or your boss or your peers test out OpenStack doing this, it is probably going to be a very bad experience in the long run. So this is for developing for OpenStack. Sorry about interrupting.
Yeah, no problem.
I hadn't said
that's
that.
That's a very important point to make.
If you want to see code, if you want to actually go and just do the installation, there's other repos that we've put up that will allow you to install it, and some other really awesome stuff. Or you can just use PackStack or whatever. So what are you doing here?
Okay, so I'm just cleaning up the compute that I started earlier, because I don't want any dirty stuff in the file system. So the controller is up. I'm cleaning up the compute, and then I'll start it up again once this is done. So once you know we get the compute up and running, then we'll go back to the browser and check if you know that if the controller can see that hypervisor, and then we'll spin up a VM inside of it.
So we'll give Mark a little bit of time. It always sucks when we're all on stage and like the awkward silence.
Yeah.
Again, absolutely my fault for realizing this was a workshop, not a presentation. So who's gotten to the point where they got Vagrant installed? Who's gotten the VMs compute starting? Okay.
Starting.
Okay. If there's look to the people next to you. The people that don't, you can go shoulder surf. Remember, pair programming. We're teams. Right, give them the non-verbals. Right, you know, don't be a greedy pair programmer. And don't give feedback to your buddy. You know, it's all right to look over the shoulder. It's all right. You learn more. We all do it faster when we help each other. Those of you that had the there's a lot, in the corner there we had a lot of the folder sharing, right? Had some Ruby gem dependencies. Were able to resolve that. Yes? No? No? Okay. Let me see. So we're waiting for this. We got 60%. Just making sure we can actually complete through the video or the workshop. So there's the self-paced videos. The feedback that we've been capturing, there's the screenshots, and everyone has the code. Mm-hmm. While we're waiting for that, still going. There we go.
May I?
Excuse me.
Okay. Yeah. So, I'm bringing up the compute node. Is this on?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. But I've got the log on screen. I think I can log in before the compute comes up, or I should wait. That would be kind of one question. And then I don't know the credentials.
It's admin.
Okay.
And then a password is password.
Awesome. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. And that's also in the Stack RC file.
Yeah, you can later on when you have time to play around with this yourself, you can go to the local conf of the controller and the compute, and then you can set up, mainly the controller. You can set up the admin password over here, and also a bunch of other passwords. I just make them all the same, since this is for testing purposes. Yeah, so that's how you customize that.
For those of us who are struggling with the Nokogiri gem and that was messing with the mounting the file system locally,
mm-hmm.
can you repeat the bit again where is it mounting it on my Mac host?
Repeat that, sorry, can you?
So the SIFS or NFS mount that you were talking about, which is shared on the guest
shared
and
folder.
The host.
Oh.
Yeah, the shared folder.
Yeah.
Where's the location of that?
To comment it out. Line 18, 22.
It's in the vagrant file, right here.
There's the second line, I think, right? So customizing the VM to set shared folders. So inside of vagrant, don't do
that.
So
that basically just tells, vagrant, mount the entire thing, inside of the... Mount this entire project inside of slash vagrant in the controller node.
Do you want to just leave that up there for a minute while anyone's needing to comment that out so they see it? Does anyone have trouble finding your vagrant file or understanding where to comment that out?
Line 26. Yeah, you just...
Is that the only one?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to vagrant reload. Yeah, vagrant reload. Instead of up, vagrant reload controller dash dash provision.
Can you repeat the question that was asked?
After commenting out line 26, do they still need to reload the controller?
Okay, an answer?
And the answer is just do vagrant reload controller dash dash provision.
Okay.
Line 39? That's just line 26.
Okay. Your controller.
All right, so the compute node is up. And if I refresh this one, it'll show up something over there.
Eventually, maybe.
There we go. That's the compute. Before that, let's run a simple Tempest test. So I have a sample inside the one of the readmes in this directory, not the PDF. You can go into the controller node and then run this test. So let's do that right now. Vagrant SSH controller. Sudo as root because I want to run Tempest as root. CD vagrant tempest, and then just copy and paste. I'm just going to copy and paste this test over here. This is inside of readme.md in the .git folder. I mean the devstack-tempest.git directory. So I'm just going to copy that one and paste it inside of the controller node. And that should, you know, run a few of the Tempest tests, and it'll output the results of that one shortly. Yes?
What Neutron configuration does this give you inside?
This one does not configure Neutron yet. We're going to push that configuration change sometime after this. Yeah.
So I'm still having trouble authenticating. Maybe I don't know how to spell password. I don't know. It's spelled like full word or just like Linux or something. But
no, it's just full word. Yeah.
Okay. Is what file is that defined in? I could.
You can go inside of the Puppet directory.
Okay.
And under Puppet is files. And under files is controller. And then there's local.conf over there. And that's where the admin password is set. But it should be,
yes.
I don't know, did you put in lowercase admin, lowercase
same
password?
Same
what I'm doing. Really? Is anyone else having problems logging into Horizon? Yeah. Who was able to log into Horizon?
No, actually a lot of people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that?
The only other thing is if, database isn't running or something?
I had trouble the Vagrant file share didn't copy all the folders over. It just, I see the slash Vagrant directory, but there's nothing in it.
So that's setting up the default username and password.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you have a failed step, then you need to assume that other things are going to fail after it,
yeah.
And not assume that things are going to work after that.
Well, it sounded like you were bypassing that anyway, so I wasn't sure how important it was. But
Yeah.
Obviously it's first time we've done that, so
yeah.
we're debugging it real time right now.
Yeah.
I believe the default password is secrete.
Yeah.
S-E-C-R-E-T-E
is the default password for Horizon. You can try that one.
Admin
and secrete, yeah. Basically secret with an E at the end.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. It sounds like what's happening is if the virtual or if the the guest editions plugin's not added, then the permissions aren't being set for Horizon, and we don't have an answer because we haven't run into that before. So that was one of the prerequisites, is to have that stuff set up for the class. So we don't have an answer for you right now for that.
Yeah. So if you look at the code. For DevStack, they have secret E in there as the default password. All right, so let me move on anyway. Tempest Suite was able to run over here, and it outputted the execution times. I'm just going to go ahead and launch an instance here as well. Test. Going to boot from a Syros image. And the security, just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it's launching the VM inside of our compute node. Viewing the logs over here is the progress of that VM launching. Yes. I'm uploading that right now. I will share the link inside of the Git repo in Nexus IS once it's ready. The question was, is the video going to be available online? How to find it? We'll post a link in the GitHub repo.
Yep.
All right, so.
And we love pull requests.
Yes, especially on Windows, because we don't get the chance to test this on Windows
yeah.
at all. So that would be.
Can you repeat the question louder? Yeah.
And then run all of Ubuntu.
So the statement was, if you're using Windows, don't use Windows. Boot at Ubuntu, boot Ubuntu inside a VirtualBox, and just use the Ubuntu to manage the entire environment.
Correct.
I absolutely agree with that.
You need a lot of RAM too. I suppose you have.
16, I think.
It's a lot faster than my 8 gig.
Yeah, we have a reimbursement policy for any developers who choose to use Mac. We just take what we'd pay for the crappy Dells that everyone else has. And by the way, anyone in the company can do this. And it's as long as you have support on it, if we're going to spend the money, might as well give it to you, and you can be awesome. So, look, he's awesome and looks great at Starbucks.
All right, so my VM is up and running. I was able to associate a floating IP to that one. I'll go back to my local machine over here and SSH to that. Oh wait, I have to make sure you can actually SSH. You're gonna set up the SSH rules over here.
Sure. It'd be kind of cool to extend the Denica stuff so that automatically populate. You're like, oh crap, Colin just put something in the backlog.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yeah, so do that again. Yes. I'm in the instance inside of my compute node, which I can use to ping. Whoop. What did I do?
You're in the Cirrus image.
Yes, I am.
So he's on the Cirrus image, which is inside the compute instance, which is inside the VirtualBox, which is inside of his Mac, his Mac laptop.
And if you're using Windows, that's going to be one more level down with your suggestion.
We just did a lab, and we have ESXi, three layers of ESXi, then OpenStack with Ubuntu KVM on top of yours, four.
So you're doing the vTardis lab?
What?
vTardis? It's bigger on the inside?
Four levels. We called it our cake.
Oh, there you go.
It worked.
Yeah, it's absolutely. That's actually how.
On one box, we were able to do 16 students each, and looked like they were in their own complete environment, and it was all on one
VMware. Yeah, that's how the VExperts do the virtual labs at EMC and VMworld. Yeah. It works.
Yeah.
As long as you can bubble up the CPU virtualization.
Yeah. QMU is a pain in the butt.
Yep. So that's basically it. That's just two commands, and you have a multi-node DevStack environment in your two commands after you have the prerequisites.
Yeah. So we got about 20 minutes left.
Yep.
And yes, we have questions, and let's go ahead. You had a question, ask it. You want to open up do you have the Neutron code version of the set?
Not in this one.
But can you just log into a repo and pull the new, if you log into our Denica repo?
Yeah.
Or, no, it's not on there?
Yeah, I need to reshare that code again up there.
No, so. Just to visually show it? No?
No.
No, okay. You can log into work, it's fine. Just don't show the passwords.
I need to clean up some of that.
Okay, so it sounds like it's code, like I just asked them to show the dirty underwear.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No. So it's in our internal repos right now for multi-node Neutron. But the challenge is multi-node Neutron stack RCs are out there. It's on DevStack. It's impossible to do. Does that make sense?
Yeah, because I've been trying for about a week and a half.
Yeah. Is the multi-node Neutron one on our Git repo publicly right now?
Not yet.
Okay. Yeah. So then we're...
I'm going to clean that up because I suspect there's some settings there that are not really necessary. So
okay.
Once that's ready, I'll put that up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I have to. I'm still learning Neutron.
Can I ask a question? Is this like, did anyone learn anything new with this? Yes? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, go to GitHub real quick. Yeah. So, and that's by the way the goal. You know, a lot of times in the when you're at a conference, there's a lot of stress. By the way, there's really really smart developers who are really they share in the community. I'm a really really dumb developer and I overshare in the community. A lot of times when we don't share the lessons we've learned or are learning, it hurts everyone else. So it's kind of our goal here. The goal here is to share the things that have helped us develop. And if you've been able to take one or two things or take our code and either use it yourself, you can take it, you can contribute to it, you can share it, don't care. But just makes to help other people lower the barriers to developing OpenStack.
So how do we use Puppet in real OpenStack?
Puppet in real OpenStack? Amen. You are the expert in that.
Well, that's a much larger topic than anything we could tackle here. And there's plenty of talks at this conference or at this convention for that. It's something you can't even get into in the 20 minutes we have left. It's, you know, I mean, there's plenty of information out there. And actually, Christopher, that was here earlier, would love to talk about that, I'm sure. But you need to start attending some of the meetups. Start reading some of the documentation. The Puppet Labs OpenStack modules are getting pretty awesome. You can even do something like PackStack, which is Puppet-based. You can try Foreman, which uses the Puppet Labs modules. There's a lot of stuff that uses the Puppet Labs modules. But if you want to just start learning about it, I'd just engage the community.
What's your
that
goal?
That depends on what you're trying to do, you know?
Well, so honestly, you start using configuration management, like use PackStack for single node. That's just to get one node installed. You need to figure out how. So everyone gets stuck on. And honestly, we need to. I'm going to focus on lowering barriers to development for OpenStack here, and we can engage with the community. This is for helping. This is not a we're new to OpenStack talk. This is hey, I'm trying to be a developer on OpenStack and I'm trying to develop for multi-node, and I want to make it easier. So, okay.
One more question. Actually, you guys mentioned about the automation or the configuration management for the OpenStack server side. How about the switch, physical switch side? Actually, recently, most switch vendors, they mentioned about they support Puppet Shack.
That's kind of interesting. There's a guy named Jeremy Shulman who wrote the Puppet NetDev code. He's an automation lead at Juniper. He's not here right now because he's been traveling a lot. There's also a guy named Mike Cohen who was on the NCME team from Cisco. I think Mike's floating around. There's also the PTL for Neutron that's known as Kyle Mestre that wrote the VXLint code for OBS. If you are having to configure stateful switches upstream, some of the things that we do on the Open Daylight code, right, is we have like a year ago, we wanted to answer a question let me answer your question. It takes a long time sometimes.
Oh, really?
Because they're different. No. You have your old switches. What I'm trying to say here, you have your old switches that you might have to do expect scripts, you might have to do a netconf over SSH. You may have to find whatever plugin you have and write a provider. You have to write code to do it. There's some newer switches, like the Cisco stuff has Puppet and Chef agents, but they're really only for like local package configuration right now. We're actually talking about funding some upstream work to extend some providers. There's, if you look at Puppet Net Dev for like L2 configuration, Jeremy wrote it. It's on GitHub. It works on multi platforms. It works on the Juniper stuff. If you look at the new Cisco 9000s, there's been some really good extensions to the NX API for provisioning and configuring. If you have a Arista that's OVS that runs OVS, or maybe you have an open networking switch, OVS configuration. So if you have something that speaks OVS, it supports OVS database, OVS DB, and that's our RPC protocol. So you can pass simple JSON in an extensible schema.
Yes.
So if you're automating up to that physical network layer, you really have to expose the APIs, by the way, top and bottom, because your network is the interface on your server. So things like the cobbler hooks into UCS, mm-hmm. right, and then the stuff that you're working on right now,
yep.
for B-Series, and just the platform that we have to develop on at the moment, you have to basically hook in the hardware provisioning north and south. It's easiest if you have OVS, in my opinion. If you can write into Cisco, there's a lot of Cisco network stuff out there. It just is what it is. I would not bother writing into 1PK. NX API is pretty cool. There's actually some sample code on GitHub. Look on Mike Cohen and Mark Volker. Mark Volker is here, by the way. But you can basically, you have to write your own providers right now. Hopefully they'll come out with some better providers for stateful configuration network devices. The problem is that a single network switch you can statefully configure, especially like VLAN moves. So if you need to say, I need provision upstream VLAN, okay. Now, one thing that we found out we put in actually Cisco's first OpenFlow network into production and customer base in last summer. It was all OpenFlow based. It was for a specific software development need for I can't go into the security centric customer. But for basically like monitoring or spanning port or sitting monitor ports and reflecting ports. So what we found was really interesting is that you can do test-driven development for networking by talking to a controller. So like Open Daylight is really, really cool because you can go ahead and pass in the intent or pass in, you know, basically the network definition, your application definition, and your positive negative test around that. And then whatever that controller goes and all has all the southbound plugins that you're dicking around with all your network device. Right, so it has the southbound plugins to whatever controller you choose, Ryu, Open Daylight, NSX, if you're doing VMware, MVP, I don't care. That's, in my opinion, probably the most mature way of doing it, because then you're not, that is the provider, and I like Open Daylight. I put developer time on it, because I believe in that we need an industry standard collaborative way of managing networks. Did that answer your question? No? It's hard. If you can, if you figure that out, oh, you're an Arista.
Yes.
Oh, cool.
Actually,
okay. No, talk. You know what? So I'm going to call you out on this. Calling bullshit. No. You need to talk to Bill Finner, who's one of the smartest guys in the world, and he writes your networking code. And then you need to go talk to Doug Gourlay, VP of Engineering. And then you need to go talk to Anshul. And then you need to talk to all the amazing people that at Arista, at Cisco, at Juniper. And you need to own solving that problem. Because guess what? I can't do it easily on your stuff.
There you go.
Sorry, the glasses. I mean, it's not an insult. It's just saying, you know, this network, this competitive nature that we face stops people from developing stuff. Your stuff's awesome. When Jay Sri.
Customers mentioned about the desk and the provisioning, the total solution like the Puppet Shack, but the problem is the server side. Maybe it's quite good too.
No, the problem is that networks are distributed systems. They're eventually consistent distributed systems, and that the order of operations and workflow, and the fact that we're influencing an algorithm, we're saying, hey, device, talk to this device, talk to this device. When you eventually get to the state, do this. Puppet and Chef are configuration management.
Right.
They're not built to do that. A controller does that.
Not an orchestration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right. It's not orchestration at all.
Many end users sometimes they get confused about that. Configuration management and orchestration.
Are completely different.
And you have to orchestrate a distributed system, whether you like it or not. Or make it non-distributed and make it controlled. And just have the control plane and controller. But, I mean, that's out of the scope of this discussion. But if you actually know it's within the scope. Because if you are developing for multi-node Neutron, you're probably going to be popping into exit VLANs or L3 gateways with the L3 nodes being, with advanced L3 features being inserted into Neutron right now. You're probably going to be connecting to a core ag layer. I absolutely believe the best way to do that and the easiest way to develop it, like the code that you wrote for the Puppet code for deploying Open Daylight.
Yeah.
Right? and the MiniNet code for that I think Outland wrote for passing topologies. And, did you do MiniNext with the BGP, or was that Outland?
For what, the pup code for it, or?
I don't know, yeah.
Yeah, I did pup code for
it. So the challenge is that you need to be able to put it inside of your CI pipeline. Everything has to be virtualized. I don't even know if you have a virtual image that is exposed to people so that they can develop on. Do you? No, you don't, okay. So please solve your own problem. Yeah.
You need better documentation, actually, too, about the programming API, I remember. Oh. I think it's getting better. I had a pair programming session with Ken Duda once when you were still on Fedora 9 underneath, I think. But yeah, the documentation was Ken Duda. So you need better programming documentation.
And
also,
I would say to expose more inside of industry standard protocols like OVSDB. You know, there's a lot of Cisco, Verista, Juniper, VMware all fighting over stuff. I don't care. It's an RFC. It's extensible. I think it's really great. I don't like how people put a moving target in the schemas. I think it's BS competitiveness, and it stops everyone from developing on it. But I think that giving everyone a solid. And maybe, hey, HP just joined Open Daylight. Maybe Arista should, too. So, okay. Questions, answers. We got 15 minutes on continuing to develop. It's continuing to get our development environment set up for multi-node.
So, I think we're done. You're using VirtualBox. Are there people who use lightweight containers, like LXC? Is that
a big
or not?
The question was, we're using VirtualBox. Are there people who are using lightweight containers using LXC? We're a small team. And so it was Maglana's choice. I think. Where's Mark?
Right here.
What caused your decision to choose VirtualBox versus lightweight containers or Docker or something? Or LXC?
Portability. I mean, try running an LXC on Windows.
Yeah. That being said, Docker is
right there.
Yeah.
It runs on anything, right? That's the purpose of this thing. There's Windows people here that had a little tougher time, but they ran it, right? Yeah. You can't run LXC on Windows. I can't run LXC on my Mac, for that matter. It's BSD. It's not Linux. So,
You can control Docker on Windows, although it's better to work in Linux. Also, I think there's a seminar tomorrow afternoon that's maybe doing exactly that with Docker, where they're using Docker containers to put nodes up.
So, and I will call out, we have a very small focus team. PNL does roll up to me. And so we have to make sure there's a balance of, we can't solve every problem. Yeah. If we solve problems that are good for our business, our customers, ourselves, and the community, it's really important to me to make sure that the barriers to entry to this are really low.
Yeah. They may have a Docker provider at this point. It's continually moving there. So the underlying technology for getting these VMs stood up is kind of irrelevant.
And let me make one quick statement on this. We are we're starting to develop some of our some software I can't go too deep into to deploy Linux containers. And so we'll be expanding our code base and knowledge around it. And what we try to do is share if it's an unfair advantage in the market, if it's what allows me to pay developers to do awesome things, we don't open source it. We just keep a matrix of things that support that share value in the community, that accelerate that, and then we share the burden of accelerating our business, right? And things that are part of supporting that, we release those too. I try to release as much as possible, but I got to pay people salaries. I run a very profitable business that we just got acquired, so I don't know what to do. But I'm going vacation a lot now. But there's a lot of pure plays that are it's a religious thing, and they take a religion out of business, right? I think it's really cool. We're adding 8 more developers to our team in the next 6 weeks, I think, and they're all funded profitable, right? And they're releasing stuff back to the community, and that's sorry about the kind of going on a segue on that, but I really want to actually release a lot more of the LXC stuff. Hopefully I'll be able to. I won't write it, but I'll approve releasing it. So, sorry about interrupting you there. You had probably a really good statement.
Just to close the loop, when you install Docker on Windows, they do it through Vagrant. it doesn't actually run on Windows. It brings up machines in VirtualBox. So I'm not sure if Vagrant will direct. Anyway,
that's funny.
Work out the connections, but just.
Yeah. I think Docker's amazing, by the way. I have some friends that are I really, really think are amazing, and they're some of the early guys in PaaS that are doing some interesting things in their platforms with Docker. Especially the ability to just sync file systems probably will enable our development workflow to be a little quicker. I will absolutely say that we haven't put a lot of development focus into it, but I'd say Docker and OpenShift are pretty interesting.
Yeah.
So.
Who still has USB keys out there? All right, there we go.
Okay, who stole USB keys? They all left.
Yeah. It's like the Tabasco sauce.
Today? No, this is Colin's personal USB key fund. I wanted to create a USB raid array. And so it said, you know, my excuse for doing that will be just create a talk. And anyways. So if you are done with the keys, if you return them to the front, please. If you aren't done with them, you can use them. Any other questions or answers or discussion points? You got one, stand up and ask. There's.
Nice.
So use positive feedback, you used Windows, and it worked perfectly for you.
Yeah. The only thing I had to do was the EVGS.
Okay.
That issue, while you guys put up on the screen, I had to run that in the after I booted the compute and the controller nodes, I had to run that command to sync up the directory.
Yeah.
And then I reloaded it, and it worked fine.
Cool.
Nice.
So you had to do it.
Same for me. You
got it working?
I'm not sure about my compute node, but at least my controller is working.
Very cool.
Okay. Can I ask a favor? Mark, Eamon, can you guys come up on stage?
Okay.
No.
You're going to embarrass us now.
Oh, no, I'm not going to embarrass us. I just want to make sure. So it's always a kind of a risk emotionally. You know, we all worry about being the expert. And the reality is we are a community, and we grow by sharing with each other, being open and honest, and sometimes taking a risk. Can you join me in just thanking them for all this work and being honest? Cool. I want to thank you guys. And we're going to stick around for the minutes, but thank you for participating in this with. Hopefully you've gained and shared, and if you have shared or if you have gained, please tell us and everyone. It's as good. Thank you.
The Windows connection.